Are you taping here?
We're ready.
All right, great. Welcome everyone for joining us. We are here in gallery number 5 at the Abel Contemporary Gallery. And we are featuring the work of Katie Hudnall and Tom Loeser. And they have a fabulous show right now called Boxing Match. I'm gonna tell you a little bit about each of them, and then we're gonna start to talk about their background, and then we're gonna talk about the work specifically in the show. So, Katie Hudnall is an illustrator, sculptor, woodworker, furniture maker, educator, and the current head of the woodworking and furniture department at the University of Wisconsin in Madison. Hudnall received her BFA in sculpture from Corcoran College of Art and Design, and her MFA from Virginia Commonwealth University in furniture design and woodworking. Her work has been included in many publications and exhibitions, including Crafting a Continuum, Rethinking Contemporary Craft, Making a Seat at the Table, Women Transform Woodworking, and in American Craft Magazine's February-March 2017 issue. Her work is currently featured in an exhibit, This Present Moment, Crafting a Better World, at the Renwick Gallery of the Smithsonian American Art Museum, which is up through April 2nd, 2023. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And so there's plenty of time for you to all go and see that. Tom Loeser has been head of the wood and furniture area at UW-Madison since 91. Now retired. He holds a BA from Haverford College, a BFA from Boston University's program in artisanry, and an MFA from the University of Massachusetts, Dartmouth. Loeser designs and builds one-of-a-kind functional and dysfunctional objects that are often carved, painted, and always based on the history of design and object making as a starting point for developing new form and meaning. He received 4 visual artist fellowship grants from the National Endowment for the Arts. In 1993, he spent 6 months in Japan on an NEA Creative Artist Exchange Fellowship. In 2003, he spent 6 months teaching and researching in London. Over the years, Tom has collaborated with his wife, Bird Ross, on the design and fabrication of many works, some which local people will be familiar with, including the reception desk for the new Madison Children's Museum and the Stoop Project as part of the 2013 Wisconsin Triennial at the Madison Museum of Contemporary Art. In 2012, Loeser worked with willow furniture maker Dave Chapman and built 3 large willow and steel pod forms that are permanently installed reading retreats in the children's section of the new Downtown Public Library in Madison, Wisconsin. So go and see all those things, they're fantastic. So thank you all for joining us, and thank you, Tom and Katie. So, I believe we started talking about this show last year. The gallery hosted a show about boxes that a lot of people, including you, both participated in. Was that when you started to talk about doing this show, or was it something you had ideas about much before that?
I have a different perception. My perception...
I'm sure yours is right.
Well, I started coming here, and I always especially loved what was happening in this room. And so then I think Katie and I put together this very rough kind of proposal and emailed it to you. And you said, oh, we're booked out 3.5 years. We'll take it, you know, we'll take it under consideration. So we said, okay. And then something must have changed in your schedule.
Right.
And then you emailed us back and said, we have an opening. And it's
yes, now. You're right.
And then we replied in about 35 seconds and said, yes. and that was maybe like 7 or 8 months ago that we said yes. And so then we started talking. I mean, I think we only gave you a very sort of rough idea, but we did say that we had an idea about working with boxes.
Right.
And then Katie and I started meeting and had a couple of sort of brainstorming sessions and generated all these ambitious lists and ideas and concepts. And then we sort of went our own way and disappeared into our studios and made this work.
Yeah. And so, you know, 7 months might seem like a lot of time, but to create bodies of work, you actually have really kicked it into high gear, I think. So well done. So, you know, when you're working with someone, collaborating, feel free to find your way in here and there's spots, yeah. Have either of you collaborated with another artist before on a show?
Not of this scale, but I've collaborated with other artists on pieces before.
Okay.
But yeah, I've never done a
two-person
show before, which is a lot of fun.
Yeah. But do you want to talk about some of the other collaborations you've done?
Sure. I mean, it's always been, I do better if I can make part of something and hand it to somebody, or if somebody makes something and hands it to me, and with the understanding that neither of us will be offended by what the other does. Trying to like actually find my way into making something when I'm worried about somebody. I'm somebody who would rather go to a restaurant I don't like than make a choice for other people. That's how I am, that's how I'm built. So like, in order for my sort of work to feel like mine, it's easiest for me to have a little solitude and be making my work in my shop space by myself, usually. So the collaborations that I've done, I did one with B.A. Harrington, who's a really great artist who went through the UW program a few years ago, 2008 maybe, 2007, and now runs the Indiana University of Pennsylvania, very confusing, woodworking program, and she had an incredible show at the Center for Creative Craft and Creativity in North Carolina, and she asked if I would make a part of a piece, and I collaborated with her on that. Which is really lovely. I essentially talked to her, had some wonderful conversations, made something, and she said, okay, I'm going to take that and do something with it, and now it did. But that's sort of like where my collaborations have begun to live in that way.
And Tom, have you collaborated?
Yeah, I've done quite a bit. I've collaborated with a metalsmith.
I mean, obviously with Bird.
Yeah, I was going to get to that, but I've collaborated with a metalsmith and made a series of lamps, and I collaborated with a glass artist and made a that was also a series of lamps. So for me, it's always been really interesting to collaborate with people that have a specific skill set that's very, very different from mine, and then just sort of, I think it's hard for makers like us to sort of give up control or share control, but I think it's sort of a healthy thing to have to do. And then in the end, probably the person I've collaborated the most with is my wife, Bird. And we've collaborated on a bunch of different things, both short-term and long-term permanent projects. But it's actually really been good for me because Bird is like smart and efficient and knows how to make things fast and source cheap and good materials, all things that I'm really bad at. And so we've had some very successful collaborations, I think. And yeah. And I think this is just sort of like a little bit different from that kind of a collaboration, because this is more, we really, in the end, although we had all these talking sessions in the beginning, we're both sort of people that like to work on our own by ourselves in our studio. And so we did that. I will say that Katie publishes a lot on Instagram, so I pretty much see her daily output. That was really interesting because that was a way to sort of really keep up with what the other person was doing. And I would do the same, my sort of lame one, you know, simple Instagram post. When I finish a piece, I would take a picture and put it up. But you did comment that you noticed them. So,
it's like, shit, oh God.
But so that was sort of interesting that in some ways our back and forth did happen by sort of putting images online. And so it was more of a sort of a dialogue kind of collaboration rather than collaborating on a specific piece, although there are three sort of very simple collaborations that are in this exhibition. It's actually this J-shaped piece. That one, Katie did the form. She did all the woodworking and then handed it to me, and I did all the painting. And the one just to the right, I made the box and gave it to Katie, and she did this amazing line drawing work on it. So, and there's a third one right there that Bird just pointed to. Those are the only true collaborations, but I do think the good thing that happened, I think, you know, as we were installing the show this week, is we realized that the work really does talk back and forth a lot. So it's not going to, yeah.
So, Katie obviously succeeded you in your position at the university. Did you know each other professionally prior to that? And the reason I'm asking is spending the week with the two of you while you're installing. it's really lovely how much affection you have for one another and just really love of each other's work. And so it seemed like the whole thing just seemed like a joy to work together. And I was just wondering what your history is together and how aware you were of each other's work before doing this project.
So I think we met at a Furniture Society conference in like 2007 or 8. But the thing that, the way that I got to know Tom was that after I graduated from VCU in Richmond, Virginia, I was working in cabinet shops in Richmond and taught a class adjunct in the evenings. And in February of 2009, I got laid off from my job because the cabinet shop I was working for shut down. It was in the recession. And I was looking around trying to figure out what I was going to do. I was still teaching adjunct in the evening, and the chair of the program, craft program there, Sonia Clark, said, while you're not busy, would you be willing to chauffeur Tom Loeser, who's coming to the program as a visiting artist, around for 3 days? Because you clearly aren't doing anything else, you just lost your job. And I was like, that would be dreamy. It will give me 3 days and not have to think about what I'm going to do right now. And so I knew you professionally, but I didn't know you very well. And the first day, I must have lost Tom 7 times, because I would be like, and so we're just going to go, and he'd be like, looking at something. What is this? What is this thing? And I'd be like, I don't know. I've lived here for 7 years. I've never seen it before. So it was lovely to sort of spend that time. And at the end of that trip, Tom asked if I would come and be a resident artist at UW in the fall. And that, at that point, I realized I only had to find a job that got me through the summer, because I was going to come here and be the resident artist, and I would. But that's my memory of sort of how we got to know each other. It was like that. It was so much fun to sort of drive you around town and get to be your chauffeur.
we must have been in a lot of group shows. So this realm of whatever you call this work that we do, it's a very small group of artists around the country, and we pretty much all know each other,
yeah.
And so, and end up often in group shows,
yeah,
together. So I'm sure that we've been in a bunch of group shows, but we both realize that we've very rarely done this sort of two-person show where two bodies of work sort of have a conversation going on.
Yeah.
I think that was one of the nicest things about this opportunity. And then I would say, for me, retiring from UW in 2020, the fact that they hired Katie to keep this crazy one-person program going made it really easy to leave, you know, to sort of turn it over to Katie, and it's great. I'll add one more thing, which is,
yeah,
the program has really had three people running it. The first person was Skip Johnson from Stoughton, who lived a couple miles down 138. And Skip ran it for 30 years, and then I ran it for 30 years, and now Katie's taken it over.
You've got 30 years,
Katie. 28.
But Katie was commenting, yes, during the install, we were sort of talking about that, and the fact that there is a sort of an interesting connection in all three bodies of work. And Katie's comment was it all uses a sort of a, each person has a sort of distinctive sense of humor, but humor is very much in everybody's work. Is that accurate?
I think that's totally accurate. And interestingly, my mentor at Virginia Commonwealth University is a gentleman named Bill Hammersley, who's retired from that program now. But his mentor was Skip Johnson. He went to this program. So Skip is sort of like my woodworking grandfather.
That's great.
Yeah.
Well, so I know that this week during setup, you had this couple scraps of paper or something that had these,
yeah,
notes, which were early formations of ideas. So what was on those paper?
I'm sorry, I think they're in the back pocket of a different pair of
So
we met maybe 3 times for walks, and then we gave ourselves an assignment to sort of generate a list of possible concepts for box making. And the lists were pretty long once we consolidated the list. It was a couple pages of sort of box concepts.
I've got some of them here. So it was like a surprise box, a box for your oldest memory, a box made of trash, a box on wheels, a toolbox, a box that is also a tool, a hybrid box, a box with a very specific function, box car, inside the box, outside the box, time box from outer space. And y'all had snake box, which I loved, and I never made it, a bento box, a grudge box, a small box for a big idea. idea. A box that is also jewelry. A jewelry box. A traveling box. Box car. Shoe box. A box that holds 12 boxes. Match box. A box that changes its stories when open. They just like, we were just sort of brainstorming, and then we sent each other our lists. There were so many overlaps.
Yeah.
And we didn't make a single one.
So that list is still very much in front of us, and so we've been talking about planning the rematch. But I think it just. I actually think it was important that we did that list making.
But I do, and more and more you talk about it, I want the rematches. Now I want to see the box with grudges in it.
Yep.
And the box with 12 boxes in it.
Yep.
Although, Katie, you have a box with 3 boxes in it. There's numerous things. Should we start looking at some of the boxes and how they open? And if I can we start with this? Because this just knocks my socks off.
So this is a little bit older. This is pre this show. I made this my first year in Madison, so it's a year and a half old. And this holds 10 maple seeds, but very useful. And then closes sort of like a traditional pencil box. So I made this object first. And I wanted to talk about value a little bit and what I value specifically. And then I wanted to talk about this thing that I'm really interested in work, which is why everything has a lens or an eyeball on it, which is this sort of like notion of awareness in the pieces a little bit. So I wanted to make something that would keep these safe. So this box closes, this slides on here. And then to lock that so it won't slide open, you shift that over so it's no longer making an eye. So anytime an eye is revealed, you're being watched as you're sort of looking at the contents. And then this slides back into this, so this piece came next. And then in order to lock that in place, loosen this, and then those close. So when it's sort of closed, you feel less like you're being watched. But then when it's open, so when I do that, the box won't come out. I can't do it. Once I loosen that and open those, now I'm being watched, but I can open the box. So it's just this sort of notion of being aware that this thing is aware as you're doing what you're doing.
And then was it a conscious, because we talked about this last night at the opening, that you didn't have a sketch of the whole thing and then just constructed it from a plan.
No, I started with the center part. And then again, I think that's part of why, like for me, collaboration can be hard. It's easier for me to sort of hear what the work wants. Like I feel like it's often a collaboration with the materials. And it's all reclaimed. So everything I make is made out of found materials, dumpster dive materials, all the plywood, pretty much everything, except for the springs.
Well, because, and these end up, it looks like it's going to walk or skitter across the room or something.
I was thinking about grasshopper.
Great.
In this.
Yeah.
I wanted some kind of sort of bug-like creature to sort of
One thing I heard you say before about this one is that you built it from the inside out.
Yeah.
That's an interesting conceptually.
Yeah. Yeah, so I made this, and then I built this, and then I knew I wanted these eyeball sort of mechanisms to open and close, and I figured out how to get them to do that, but then I needed enough length to sort of have the string go back and then come back around. And so the leg structure came from that. So it's, I'll make part of it and then I'll draw the next section and I'll make that part and then I'll draw the next section. So like, usually it's sort of a matter of making something and realizing that in making something I've created 4 problems. And then I solve those 4 problems and I create 10 problems. And I just keep going until I don't have any problems left. That's how I know the pieces up.
And it's great, you know, this idea of an elaborate holder for something that doesn't need necessarily to be held that elaborately is great. I mean, while we're right over here, this compass box, show us that. I think that's just great.
So this is, I make a lot of really useful tools. This is probably my most useful tool. It's a four pencil compass holder, so you can draw four concentric circles at once, and then the case that it goes into is here. So then that closes up, and that locks. And then to open it, you have to clip that latch. And it opens. It's got a little pencil sharpener for it in there as well, which my friend Silver has also said I had to include, so I did. And you have to have the right length pencils for it, and it only comes with one set, so you have to be working on those while you're going, because if these are too long, they don't fit anymore, which I discovered the hard way.
It's great, and everything of yours, and often there are these eye motifs, but there's also four windows. What's that all about?
I like this idea of thinking about interior spaces. It's part of why I like boxes so much, is like they're the secret keepers for furniture, right?
Yeah.
Like chairs and tables keep secrets, but they're subtler and they tend to be more touch related. You know, like I think everybody has that sort of experience of like knowing intimately the underside of their kitchen table and the spots that have been sort of worn away or fixed or repaired or have gum stuck to them or whatever it is. Like you sort of know those secrets by haptics, you know, by touch. But boxes and cabinets are like it's built into their DNA that they hold things, that they keep secrets. And so I like this sort of reminder that there's a way in, that there's something inside. And I like thinking about that inside having an intelligence, which again is why
And your work for a long time has been about cabinets and boxes and containment.
Yeah.
And then Tom, you make boxes and cabinets and all kinds of things too. And so how do you approach making a container? You don't have eyes or windows.
There's still time.
How do I approach it?
I mean, and yours have their own sort of surprise inside. I mean, even.
I mean,
you can grab anything and open it up, and the inside is handled.
Yeah, maybe I should just open up.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think actually part of it for me is that I think boxes are going to be quick. And I start a lot of things thinking they're going to be quicker than complicated pieces of furniture. But then I think, you know, because I'm very interested in surface treatments, very often I'm spending longer on the actual finishing part of the piece than on the construction of the piece. And that's just partly because it's what I like to do in the studio. So I spend a lot of time mixing paint, doing carving and textures and surfaces. And here's a couple more. So I don't know, I don't always do that, but just it just worked out that with a lot of these boxes, I kept the brighter colors on the inside. But maybe one thing that might be relevant is for both of us, quite a number of these pieces are what woodworkers would call bandsaw boxes, where you start with actually a large chunk of wood and you work subtractively using primarily a bandsaw as a drawing tool. And cutting the block of wood apart, removing certain sections, and then reconstructing the box with hollows in it at that point. So these complicated profiles and Katie's wall cabinets are created with the bandsaw.
Yeah.
And so it's actually a really interesting process because it's usually additive to make a large block of wood, or you might just start with a large block of wood, then it's subtractive, cutting it apart, and then it's additive again as you put the thing back together. And it's actually one of the faster ways to construct things out of wood, which is, I think, part of why it's appealing. I don't know, it's just, I think most of the boxes that I have in the show, the foundation of them were probably made with that construction system. I don't know, you want to add a follow-up question?
Yeah, well, I just want to grab a few more and bring them over.
Yeah.
I love these ones too. And yeah, the tilting one.
This is my favorite. I'll just steal this from the show.
They're beautiful, but But there's a sense of humor about them, and again, you're sort of thinking about creative ways to have them open.
Yeah,
what's the function of a box?
So I guess with that one, I was thinking about the effect of the thing that you put in the box. So the idea that if you put something in this side, if you take the lid off, put something in there, it might go like that.
So you know where your collection is.
Yeah.
You know which side it's on.
Yeah.
And could you ever get it, you know, weighted so that it just
totally balanced?
That
would be a good one.
Yeah.
That'll be in the rematch.
Speaking of secrets, I love these for this.
Oh, yeah.
Isn't that beautiful?
It's like a painting. You get
a
bonus painting
on
the lid.
Yeah, I guess another thing that I like about working with boxes and this approach to making boxes is you can actually be fairly spontaneous. In other words, you can start with a block of wood and a freehand pencil working in the shop. You don't have to sit down at a drawing table and work things out ahead of time. That piece would not really be buildable unless you had a drawing done ahead of time to sort of think it through. But these can be more spontaneous, which is actually what I enjoy in the studio. So this one was just based on the idea of a box within a box.
Which I think was on the list too.
That might have been on the list.
Yeah.
And then this sort of slightly displaced mini lid that lets you access the little box.
So you don't have to be bothered.
So while we're here, open.
Yeah, so it's not totally disconnected from this. This is, would probably be classified as a blanket chest, but it came from thinking about function, and actually blanket chess is a category I've made a lot of blanket chess, and various different approaches to blanket chess, starting looking at very traditional colonial six panel chess at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. But I've thought a lot about blanket chess, and one of the things with blanket chess is they usually have a lid that opens, but nobody has a blanket chess that they don't pile stuff on top of the lid. And so I was interested in the concept of a lid that doesn't ever have to move. So the lid stays in place and the actual box just rotates its way out. Huh. And it can actually swing around if you have a big enough space. And then those are meant to be seating places where you can sit. And then I guess I could maybe talk about.
Yeah, I would love. Yeah, please do.
Okay, so these are I don't remember where this idea started exactly, but it's just the idea that it's basically a expanded yoga block. So with the yoga block, you've got three positions, and so I do know where this started. It actually started, I've always had this sort of interest in a piece of furniture that has all usable sides. It doesn't have a bottom. And so the idea with these is that they have six usable surfaces. And so even the part that's down against the ground is actually a usable surface. You could flip this around the other way. But this particular cube has six different colors of cowhide on it. And the idea is you can have it in the low position, and this is actually standard chair height, and this is more like bar stool height. So each of them is multi-positionable. And there was a lot of things that happened in the thought process of developing these. I took these at one point to get photographed, and the photographer said, these are exactly like apple boxes that they use in photographer studios. And he said they're used in group portraits where the photographer has to adjust people's height. And he said the photographer will yell to the assistant, set it up LA, which means set it up like low to the ground, or set it up Chicago, or set it up New York. And I've never quite understood like which is Chicago, which is New York, right? Doesn't Chicago have the tallest one? I don't know, what do you think, Tom?
Yeah, I think that's Chicago.
This is Chicago and New York. So I thought that was sort of interesting, and I've gone that you can actually order them from photography supply places. But that's sort of how these developed. And these were
These were upholstered by Matthew Nefranowicz at the Strick Thread in Shanks Corner in Madison. And so we had fun sort of working together and figuring out the logistics. And they're sort of simple, they're just cubes, but actually to get this sort of nice upholstery effect, it's a fairly complicated structure inside. But Bert, what am I forgetting?
And that's what I was going to say about the looking at the photographer's boxes.
Uh-huh, yeah. So that was the background, and so the idea is you can manipulate them in any direction.
They're great. It's really terrific. And it's interesting that you made them. I thought that you knew about the apple boxes, and that's why you made them, but
no.
You made them without even realizing.
I do find that a lot of ideas, I sort of carry them around and then layers get added onto them. And the original thing with this idea is that idea of furniture that doesn't have a bottom on the floor that can rotate in all dimensions.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's actually where we started.
So another thing that I think is really interesting about similarities in the two of you and your work, it manifests itself in very different ways, but you both paint on your pieces. How did that develop in your vocabulary of your work? Start, Katie.
Well, Tom's a huge influence. I knew Tom's work in grad school. So it was really refreshing to see people who weren't like, you can't paint that, that's wood.
Right.
I use all reclaimed materials. So often painting makes sense anyway because.
Say that louder. I use
all reclaimed materials. So like if I assemble something out of all reclaimed materials, it often looks like this. This is the way my pieces kind of start. And it can feel really gimmicky to just have a million different woods on there. Some people really like the look of it, but to me it feels still like a lot of separate things have come together, and when I paint something, it unifies it. Mm-hmm. All of those materials have now gone through one thing together. And it feels like that. They feel like an object and not like a whole bunch of stuff. And since I use a million tiny parts, it's helpful for them to all have gone through a process together. So I like painting for that reason. And patterns do something so interesting when they wrap around a three-dimensional form. They change everything. So And patterns with forms are really interesting to me too. So like, this is a shape, but now it's symmetrical. Like there's something really lovely to me about what doors do. Tom says something similarly beautiful over here. The way that this form matches the negative space in there is so beautiful. And so like, patterns in paint are really interesting, but patterns in form are also interesting, and they do something really fascinating together. But My mom worked in a fabric store. That's why the patterns, I think. I spent most of my childhood sitting on bolts of upholstery fabric, waiting to go home while doing homework. So I think pattern is just like in there, and then seeing people who were using it in such a dynamic way on three-dimensional forms and making wood feel like fabric often, which is a lot of what Tom does. I mean, these things feel ceramic, or they feel. They remind me of quilts, like they touch some of the other materials by their patterning, so.
Yeah, I thought the reason I closed this one is I think like one of the really interesting things, you might have to come look at this later, but is a paint pattern of suggestion of form that actually contradicts the actual physical form underneath it. So the painted surface is suggesting something very different from what the physical surface does.
Yeah.
Like these two, I just really love these little sections in here. So this isn't directly about paint, but one of the things that's really important in all of Katie's work is that if you look at the materials list, the material is always found wood. Mm-hmm. So that's really important. And like, if you go for a walk with Katie, usually by the end of the walk, Katie has sort of various things in her hands that she's picked up along the way. And that's where the materials are coming from. So I think that's really important about the work.
So back to paint.
Yeah.
So as long as I've been familiar with your work, Tom, you've used paint, and I know a bit about your peer group, and it does seem something unique to what you do. Certainly,
right.
You're not the only person who's ever done this, but did you start painting? Because no, there weren't like a ton of people doing what you were doing at the time.
Yeah, so I can locate myself like in the context. So when I went to woodworking school, the aesthetic was really natural wood, really natural wood. My two main mentors, professors, were sort of influenced by Scandinavian style of furniture making. But the thing that was going on in the design world that was really quite influential was the Memphis movement in Italy. And so they were, we would see that work in Domus magazine that you could, Domus, you know, that came out, like seemed to come out every 3 or 4 months, an issue would show up in the library. And you could sort of see what was going on. And I'm not necessarily crazy about the actual Memphis pieces. I don't really like them that much. But it was really, really important in terms of what they were saying, that you could put together this harmonious, it wasn't all about harmony and sometimes putting things together that don't look like they should go together does interesting things. And the use of color and pattern and surface was really, really exciting to me. And so that's kind of when I started playing around with it and using it in conjunction with wood. And it is really interesting because in our peer group, there's a certain sort of group of people that think it's really terrible to paint beautiful wood. It's really, but I don't really see it that way. I see it more as the paint is a compliment. And so as I started to get interested in color and trying to teach myself about color, wood has this incredible sort of range and variety of grain and so forth. And you kind of think it has a lot of different, there's a lot of different colors of wood, but if you locate the spectrum of woods on a color wheel, it's still a pretty narrow slice of pie. And so if you want to use the full color wheel, you have to start introducing other stuff. I mean, the one wood that's green when you cut it is poplar, but the green fades after a couple weeks, so there is no green. And so if you want to get over to that side of the color wheel, you got it. That's one of the things that enticed me to use color. And then I just really enjoy mixing paints in my little coffee cups. I spend tons of time just mixing paints and making sample blocks. I have a drawer full of sample colors. And then I think another thing that's kind of interesting is both of us like to explore color, but we both use a lot of black and white. Mm-hmm. And it's sort of funny because I think like I'll work with, you know, fairly saturated colors, but after a while, black and white is almost like a safe harbor, like a thing to go back to. And I'm not quite sure. I'd be curious what you would say about it.
I was much less confident in my color early on, and the thing that my parents host a white tie New Year's Eve party every year that they inherited from my grandparents, actually. And my mom always used to say, everyone looks so good wearing black and white and like one other color.
Mm.
And so for a while, my sort of goal with my work was, if it's found wood and it's got some like weird, interesting, cruddy paint on it already, and I add black and white to that, it doesn't matter what that other paint color is, it's going to look good. So it was a crutch for a while, but I find it's just a way to sort of break up space really in a very illustrative sort of manner. And my first love is illustration, drawing. So I think it sort of does two things for me. And I think what's interesting to me about some of your stuff is like you do this illustrator's trick. You know, when you're illustrating something, the lines that are really important, you want to make them a little heavy, like a little bit darker. And you do that with the wood coming back through when you chamfer some.
Mm-hmm.
You like sort of outline all your pieces with this beautiful darker wood that's coming through that has like a little bit of a sheen. It's not black, but it looks like it sort of reads as like an outline, which I love. It's like all your pieces glow and you can find the edges really beautifully.
I guess one other thing I would say about color is because I was sort of describing it, I like mixing paint. I think one of the things that I especially enjoy with color is taking a color that's not very exciting when you look at it in your cut. It's just sort of a really basic color. And I almost think it doesn't really matter what color you start with, and what starts to work is just when you build off of whatever your first color ends up being and try to make that
art, you know, ugly sort of army green, make that ugly army green look good by what you put it next to. That's kind of what I enjoy the most, is sort of generating that family that sort of talks back and forth.
Yeah. So Tom, so when were you starting to do the color work when you were still a student?
Yeah.
And were your instructors like, what are you crazy? This is why are you ruining this wood, or did they embrace what you were doing?
I think they embraced it. I mean, it was sort of a moment when things were shifting.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Because if they didn't, obviously, they would discourage you too much, because here we are.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of black and white, Katie, can you demonstrate this other really spectacular piece?
Sure. So this is a reliquary for two very short pencils that have sort of gotten to the end of their life. I collect those. So this is one of those pencils, and this is a bandsaw box technique. So so this piece I cut off of the block started. Actually, the block started bigger, but I won't go into that because it's a little complicated. But if you imagine this as just a solid chunk of wood, I cut one side off, and then I cut the other side off, and I took that central section. And I cut angles into it, screwed the side that I cut off here, and then it's just a pivot point over here, and then this is just a giant drilled hole. So I cheated completely, in terms of making.
It's not cheating; it's technique.
Right, I techniqued it. And so this then fits into that, and then this. Fits over top of that, and then the second pencil's in this little board here, and that fits up there. And so.
It's like a magic trick, sort of.
So, Katie, you're saying that you started with that total block right there.
I started with most of this total block. The slatted pieces on the outside were applied, were added. But yeah, the block that I started with was a rectangle, sort of this size. And then, for whatever reason, my brain, I'm really good at puzzles, and my brain can think through like how to turn something like this into something like this more easily than I could. I wouldn't have come to it if I'd been drawing. It was easier for me to draw with the bandsaw. I think it through that way.
Oh, yeah.
This is for spiders.
Well, and so I thought it would be fun to ask each of you to pick one of the other person's boxes and talk about it, and maybe that was just sort of one of whether it's your favorite or the thing that you think is sort of interesting. So I'm putting you on the spot.
Oh, well, okay, so I love that one, of course. But I think there's something about this one. What's this one called?
Two-handled box.
So I just love that you're sort of, it's just strange what it makes you do. Like it's just not.
Also for spiders.
It's not the normal. It's not the normal box mechanism. It's like you've got this thing on a stick. And so what I like about this one is what it forces the user to do to interact with it. It sort of makes you, it puts you in a sort of slightly awkward but fun relationship with the box.
Yeah, you do have to think about it because there's nothing else that really makes you do that. It's almost like being asked to pat your head and.
I mean, you could do that, but that's like declining the invitation.
Right.
So I like that one.
Yeah, I like that one a lot too. Katie?
I do these little tiny ones because they're sort of easy to overlook, but I love these. These are so sweet. They're like jewels. This was one of the first ones that Tom posted, and I was like, shit. I gotta go make something. But I love, for a similar reason, like you can pinch there, right? And that sort of makes sense. But there's also this sort of sense that, like, you probably should be grabbing it that way. And again, secret keepers. You know, these beautiful little, but that shape is actually, it takes a bit to make something that small and that fine. Like, this took. took longer probably than the box below
right.
did.
So I started making this box at the beginning when I was just going into my studio and thinking, oh, what do I want to do? And I wasn't sure what I wanted to do, so I said, oh, while I'm thinking, I'm going to make these super basic little boxes. And then what normally happens is I just started making these little handles, and the handles just got more and more involved.
And then I was just thinking about, because if you were sharing with each other as you were making the pieces for the show, I don't know when exactly you came up with the boxing match title, but it is, you know, was there any sort of like, here's the one I just did, and I was like, okay, game on, now I'm going to have to.
Now, Tom started posting like pictures of finished things, and I was posting pictures of like process, but I would get something like sort of to the point where I had to actually draw on it, and then I'd be like, I don't want to draw yet, I'm going to go make something. And so when he started posting finished work, I was like, damn, okay, I gotta like buckle down and get some stuff made. And I didn't know that you were looking at what I was doing. Like, I don't know, like, I'm kind of a troll on Instagram. I'm too much on there, so I was like, I was aware.
Right.
And I was like, never compete with Tom Loeser. So I think I was the one who proposed the title, because we were like, we gotta come up with something, and I was like, boxing match.
It's great.
It's very, yeah. So I want to open it up to questions in a second, but I think before that we need to address the t-shirt in the room.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So, you go.
It's a great t-shirt.
So this is an artist, Patrick Smysek, who went through the printmaking program at UW and had a t-shirt company called Beast USA, and he did some beautiful wood-oriented ones. He had piles of firewood that were really beautiful, and we both happened to order the same shirt. Really out of coincidence. So Katie saw me wearing this a couple days ago and said, hey, I have that t-shirt.
Yeah.
So we did agree we would wear them today.
I noticed that we both had things at the top of them in case the other one forgot. I have like 6 or 7 of Patrick's shirts. So I really love them. He's now one of the master printers at Tandem Press, so
yeah.
He's not. His t-shirt company is defunct, but my hope is that it will come back at some point. Because they're really fun.
Yeah. One other thing I would say is this space is especially appealing because it's kind of unusual. It's not common to have this kind of walls in an exhibition space. So it's really fun. It's especially perfect actually to have two white walls and then two tobacco warehouse walls. And I think that actually adds a lot to what happens in the space.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's our gallery. When my husband and I went, our first gallery was in an old creamery, and there was a walk-in cooler.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where we had special exhibitions. And we loved the way that it forced the artists to really think about the space and interact with it, and make sure the space wasn't overpowering it, but it created a really interesting dialogue or something. And so we wanted to recreate that. So in the rest of the gallery, almost all the walls are painted white, but we thought it was important here to leave this history of building it. The shows in here are just knockouts like this one, and no pun intended with the title of the show. yeah, I love the way that the work looks with it.
I think it's also partly the entry, the way you sort of come in.
Yes.
Yeah.
I was going to say, I had one other thing, which is that in my, I partly as a result of teaching, one of the things I would always teach in the woodworking classes is cutting dovetails, which is sort of really basic to box making. And I actually have a bunch of dovetail boxes that I've made teaching as demonstration boxes in my shop. And they've been sitting there through the whole 8-month creative process, however long it was. And I kept thinking, I'm going to finish these for the show. I'm going to make these for the show. I'm going to put these boxes in. But it just sort of came down to the end, and I just like kept looking at them. And then I realized it just didn't really fit like with the conversation that was happening. And so there isn't a single dovetail in the exhibition. And it's just kind of interesting because it was sort of about something different than that. Then I could never get them to work in the group in my head.
Right. Yeah, I have a similar thing with my salon. Because I taught boxmaking this semester with my students. We focused on that. And none of the demos, because they're just rectangular forms I could have carved, or, but they weren't as much fun.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
it was similar. But I think one of the things that I appreciate about your work is that you'll go with whatever technique is interesting to you and not with the thing that is like sort of the most techie.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that there's a tendency in woodworking to think like if I'm not dovetailing it, then it's not enough. But there's so much you can do with this material. And
right.
it isn't about the technical often. It's about something else. And like sort of letting the creativity be the thing that's the driver and not sort of like the process of the technique. So
well, that's to sound strange, but that's kind of when the art comes out. Because I think there's a lot of media where artists can get really wrapped up in the technique
right.
and then talk themselves out of creative decisions mm-hmm. because they're afraid it's not
right.
going to be impressive enough.
Right.
And you really have to follow what's the right thing for the thing you're making.
Right, yeah. In grad school, I had a friend who would always say, appropriate craft, like whatever that is, whether that's a nail or a dovetail, like, you know, find a thing that's right for the moment.
Right.
Which is great. It's like, it's definitely nails for me.
The worst. And whatever those things are, it's often the thing that you might be the most, you would have initially been the most, nervous about showing the
right.
thing that's not like the finest craft,
right.
that often becomes your signature thing or your real voice as an artist, I think.
Yeah.
Questions?
It was late. Did you talk about when you were children? Like, what did you have a mentor or a woodworker inspiration or what made you start putting things together? Because that always makes me tick. I want to know.
And we didn't cover that, so good question.
Okay. Well done.
I went to a college I got accepted into a college at a time that they actually sent out a letter encouraging you to consider taking a year off before you showed up at the college.
Oh, wow.
And when I got the letter, I thought, ooh, that sounds like a good idea. And they promised to hold a place for you the following year. And so I took a year off and I worked in a woodworking shop. That's just the honest truth. I just told Katie this, but my boss was called Chip Carpenter. and I worked in that shop for that year, and that's one of the things that got me started, and one of several things that got me started in woodworking. But I wasn't...
Did you do art in high school or?
Yeah, I did some. I did some. Yeah, I did.
And at that point, did you consider it as a profession early?
No,
okay.
No. I went to college and then I moved back to Cambridge, Mass, where I grew up. And one of my best friends, Mitch Ryerson, was in the woodworking program at Boston University, where I ended up. And I just got into that. I got sucked into it by visiting him, going and seeing what he was up to. So that was a really big influence. I don't know. I mean, for me, there was a sort of a comfort with making objects that were somehow connected to function. It wasn't the same as starting with a blank canvas on a wall where you had to sort of develop concept out of nothing. You got to have a dialogue with functionality. And that's always been the sort of comfort zone for me. That's sort of where I start thinking about the objects. I think about how does the traditional object function? How can that be sort of bent or inverted or inflected to make it mean something a little bit different? And that's sort of my comfort zone for thinking about object making. Mm.
So, and when you, so when you took a year off and then you went to that school, were you studying art? At that time, did you declare it a major?
When I went to woodworking school? When I went to regular college?
Yeah,
I majored in sociology and
okay.
anthropology.
Now we're
because those were the cool professors.
What are you saying about art professors?
Oh,
okay. You didn't know.
Yeah.
You didn't realize how cool you all were.
Yeah.
Katie, your formative.
So I grew up drawing. I was awful in school. I had a lot of learning disabilities. some of it associated with bad eyesight, but a lot of it, I'm really good at flipping things. I'm not dyslexic, but I just can, and I always worry about letters being able to be switched. That just felt uncomfortable. Like, what if you come up to a B backwards? Is it a B? It could be. So I had a lot of concerns. Anyway, I was really good at art. I was really good at drawing, and that's what I did. But I don't have, I'm not naturally good with my hands. I'm good at drawing, but, and so I went to art school because my dad, who's very sweet and very sort of like worked for the government for 40 years, he's that sort of guy, wonderful, but not creative and not sort of bent that way, was like, well, you're kind of not good at anything else, honey. You want to go to art school? He's also more tactful than that. I don't know how he raised it, but he didn't make me cry. So, and then he drove me up and down the East Coast to art schools, and I wound up at the Corcoran, which is not, I grew up in Alexandria, Virginia, so it was right by my home. There was a sculpture class, and we did welding, which was awful. You couldn't see the thing that you were trying to do, and there was stone carving, and it was too hard, and there was plaster and smushy, and then there was woodworking, and it was wonderful, and I was awful at it, but I loved the material. I moved from being an illustration major to a sculpture major, but it took me a really long time to sort of understand how to make things with my hands. And that sort of slowness has been, I think, one of my favorite things about being a maker now. I think when you learn something, when you're bad at something for a really long time, and you learn it over the course of a really long time, you have a very different relationship with it than you do if you're a natural at something. And so for me, drawing accesses one part of my brain and my way of thinking, and woodworking accesses this much slower, longer relationship of learning that has allowed a door to never close. So
beautiful, inspiring too.
Yeah,
awesome. This is like maybe not a super interesting question, but I'm just so curious about the shape of Katie's. That like I feel like I've seen it individually, but I've never seen multiple linear pieces together in one room. I'm like, oh, it's everywhere, and I don't even know what word that shape is. You know, it's like sort of like a wedge, but it's curved and sort of tapered. And so curious, like, does the shape come from anything specific, or is there a reason why it reappears in multiple pieces?
It's a really good question. I think that the like, simplest answer is that I grew up on the Potomac River, and then in South Carolina on the coast, so boats and sails.
Oh.
I think it's a boat and sail, essentially, is a lot of where that comes from. But I've also always been interested in heraldry, which is really silly, but I'm interested in like sort of like the patterns that people use in language, and in icons and iconography. So like they become shields when they double. And so I think it like hits in several different spots. And because I find that shape in everything, like it makes sense to me. I've tried to make things that aren't that shape, and I'm always like, oh, it's almost there, and then I would sort of tweak it a little. it's definitely boats, boat related, nautical, boats and sails.
Portals.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. I have an anecdote. I was a student of Skip Johnson's in the early 70s.
Ooh.
And Skip's graduate student was your mentor, Bill Hammersley. And Bill was well known around the art department because he didn't have a place to live.
Yeah,
and so he slept illegally in the art department, in his studio or in the wood shop.
No, he slept on the lumber rack.
Well, no, he actually, what I recall, and I'm rather old now, he actually made himself, what else? A box. He made a custom box that he would sleep in. I don't recall if he had it put a lid on it so it's coffin like, but you know, after our class we'd all go out. You know, with Skip, he tended to go to bars and stuff like that, and sometimes we'd go back and put Bill to bed in his box. So he's in the box-making world as well, I don't know.
He is. He and I kept the same schedule at school, so we got to be very good friends when he was my mentor. We would get to school at like 3 o'clock in the morning together.
I haven't seen him since 75, but he was just as a grad student, he was really helpful.
He
and really great, yeah, real, really great with his time.
One of the most kind people.
when I took over and they were touring me through the shop, and they said, that's where Bill Hammersley sleeps. or that's where
he sleeps.
Thanks for that. Any other questions or anecdotes?
Just so y'all know, there aren't any grads sleeping at UW.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a different fact.
A different time that I'm aware of.
Logistics problem for our question for somebody who, you know, doesn't necessarily do art at all. So after a show like this, what do you do with all of
this? This show is easy because the work is relatively small. It's like one carload of work. I mean, the best thing is if you can keep your work out there in the world, you know, going from in exhibitions, and it's best to have it out there somewhere, not at your home.
In a box. In the basement.
Yeah.
Most of my friends have a storage unit. I have a storage unit, and like it always lives in the city that I lived in before, which is strange. But like getting everything moved. So I have a storage unit in Indianapolis that
you
has.
You still have a storage unit in Indianapolis?
I'm getting there. It's been a pandemic. It's been very busy.
How long has it been paid?
2 years.
Okay.
And I will say that Indianapolis is in fact the crossroads of America. So far I've just been able to drive there and then on to whatever show to pick up artwork. But the larger pieces. For me, what's problematic is not weight ever. This doesn't weigh anything. It's how big their footprint is, like how sticky they are. Stick-like, not sticky. They're not actually sticky, I promise. and so they're very fragile, but they don't weigh very much. So making a crate for this, also, if I have to create something, I'm using virgin materials, mm-hmm. and my whole practice is built around using reclaimed. Mm-hmm. I can make a crate out of found stuff, but it takes me so long to collect the materials, and I don't want to use that material, then I want to make something out of it. So I have a storage unit for some of the bigger pieces and blanket wrap them and keep them in a storage unit. The small works tend to sell, so they go eventually, but they're easy to store in one closet.
So, the ones on the wall, they all feel like they're floating in water. Except for this one, it's like a fisherman mesh or something, but it goes all the way up, as opposed to having a water one. Mm-hmm. No, it has a water one.
It's at the bottom.
I see.
So the last series of these that I did a series in 2020, right before the pandemic, and all of the patterns drawn on them were based on animals. Mm-hmm. So two were based on birds, two different birds, and then two were based on one on a trunk fish and one on a turtle. Mm-hmm. And this time I just sort of let myself play a little bit, but this one's sort of based on scales, mm-hmm. or feathers. And then this one sort of reminds me of fish kind of jumping mm-hmm. or moving up. This is sort of that trunk fish pattern again. It's sort of broken up into these weird hexagons. And then these two, I realized, are actually influenced by Arsene Lee Bakhtakou, which I didn't mean to do, but she's one of my favorite artists. And I sort of like, you know, when you go down a rabbit hole online and you rediscover somebody's work, I had done that like a month and a half ago, and then these sort of patterns appeared, so they're in on Lee Bakhtakou. But yeah, it's just a great form to, like Tom said, to like, be able to wrap patterns.
Particularly for the more curved boxes, things where the entire surface is painted, do you worry much about what kind of wood is the substance of the piece, or does it not really matter if it's painted?
Well, with wood, there's the theory and then there's the reality. But the theory with a bandsaw box is very, very good in terms of wood because it's a solid chunk. And so in theory, all of the wood should be happy and moving in the same way, and it pretty much works. That bandsaw boxes are just inherently harmonious. And is that what you're sort of asking about?
Well, does it
you're thinking about like what, if it's a nice wood under there or if it's like a less.
Well, both.
Right.
Is it something that's traditionally kind of fine woodworking wood? Or are you concerned about?
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you the truth is because I work so much with the wood, the natural wood showing back through the paint on the edges. I used to use mahogany because I liked the color of the mahogany, but quite a few years ago I changed over to cherry just because I didn't want to use mahogany anymore. So almost everything in here that's a painted box is cherry.
But you can see these are mahogany, right? They're old.
Those might be mahogany. Yeah.
But like you see how beautiful, really when you get it in the light, you can tell it's just gorgeous the way that darker wood comes through. It adds something that you don't know that you're seeing from a distance, but up close you really get to enjoy it.
The deal with mahogany, part of the reason woodworkers liked mahogany is it's approximately 2 times more stable than other woods. It's very, very stable.
And it's beautiful.
And so if it didn't, it would be wonderful if it didn't come from rainforests.
Right.
Yeah.
And then this is also, because we're talking about the Chicago, New York, LA boxes being finished all the way around, you often,
yeah.
You know, the bottoms, the insides are beautiful, the bottoms are beautiful.
Too, is that they're objects, they're not architecture, right? Like, so there's like rarely like, you're gonna hold it, you're gonna have a relationship to it in your hand, which is really wonderful.
This is a really, really hard show to ask people to not touch the work.
Yeah.
You're welcome.
It's inside there.
Anything else before we let everybody go up and not touch the box? Ask Tom or Katie to show them the boxes. Well, thanks everyone for showing up.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tom and
Katie.
And this show is all online. Most of the pieces are online. And this is being videotaped, and it turned out pretty good. Our mics weren't working this morning, so hopefully the audio will turn out. That will be available if you want to tell people about it. It'll be on the website, or the web page on our website. And the show is up through...
July 17th.
July 17th. All right. Thanks again.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.